I am standing here with the magic of video editing into the Hall of the Notaries from Perugia in Italy. And as the word itself, it was the building that was used for notaries to do their work. And in the library, a beautiful book actually has survived all the way up to us. It dates from about 1340s, so almost, it's more than 600 years ago. And it has those illuminations. And here, very interestingly enough, we have in the middle, sitting at the table writing, we have a notary. So this is not a religious book, right? This is just a register of different things. In this case, it registers villages and numbers of citizens. It was a little bit difficult. It was in Latin, so I couldn't figure out everything about it. But it is still known as the Book of Notaries of Perugia. Now, what's happening here? You have the guy in the middle, and someone on his left is actually standing there, probably telling him things. Please register my son. Please know that I am selling this thing. Please know that I am committing to actually engage in this activity or in this war or in this. So this is noting down things of life as a reference, and it will be put in the book of the guy on the other side, this red book, where it will be stored forever. Now, this red book does exactly the same job as blockchain, because it is a proof of something that we've left in there for safekeeping, and we can refer to it as the unique source of truth. Now, the guy in the middle is actually, you get paid for that work. Anything that has to do in providing the trust, it can give you a comfortable salary. Now, it's difficult to know in our terms of how we understand money nowadays, how we earn. We can't compare this, but what we can see is research and history tells us that this function, this kind of function at the time in 1300s, he would have been able to purchase from 200 to 400 horses per year with his salary or with his revenue. That was either for him or for his community, I'm not sure. But it is still a lot of money. That person is wealthy for the activity of writing down deeds and acts and promises into a book. And the book has survived. We have those books, not all of them, of course, but it's nice or a little bit ironic to know that the promises they made 600 years ago have survived, but their lives themselves are lost to history. We don't know anything about them, who they are, where they were, what they were doing in this illumination. So, notarization is as old as mankind. And you can have it in the Roman times were doing this. It's the principle of a third party taking or noting down a promise or a word or something that is between two people or a society and their citizens or something like this. It's a way to try to have a reference for trust so that we can come back to it later. And in today's activity, in today's life, it is absolutely everywhere. From a wedding to the certification of security for child car things, or your passport, everything is getting a contract or getting a new house, tracking some carbon data, getting a pilot license. Those are all different activities that need something in the middle, someone in the middle most of the time, to actually do some work, to take note down and prove later on when needed that this is what you have done, promised, or received, or qualified, or something like that. You might ask yourself, why am I showing a traffic sign here? Well, it's the same principle. It might not be a notary that did this, but someone wrote in the law that if a car doesn't respect this, they can get a fine. And as pedestrian, we take for granted that this is going to work, and we're going to use this. This is how we function. It's this principle of good faith, bona fide. So good faith that everything we do will be or is promised to us will achieve. And so since the beginning of time, this has always been done by a middle ground, a middle person. You always have someone somewhere or this kind of mechanism needed to provide this extra proof security for the trust. And they make a lot of money. This is an activity. Think about buying a house and paying a lawyer, or even something as trivial as renewing your passport. You're going to have to pay the administration to issue it. It's different from every country in the world. But any one of those activities always typically wants someone to be paid in the middle. It doesn't change in computer science or in computers or in business. I mean, if you have companies that help you convert the processes of your machine and make it possible to be used by another company that has another system and another machine, and they are in the middle transmitting this, making it flowing and working, then you have a revenue model for the middle, and it exists everywhere. So here brings the word of jargon, immutable. Now, immutable is the contrary of mutation. Mutating means that it evolves. Immutable is the reverse of that. It means that you can't change it. It's there forever. Now, this is in today's world, when you talk about all the example I've given you, this is more of a hope. It will stay immutable. And we put lots of layers of governments, of laws, of archives, of digital archives, of certification and all this to make it absolutely impossible to actually attack the original truth or change it or hack it. Yes? So you have all those levels of security. So we put a lot of efforts to actually make it happen. And this immutable is what we want. We want to be able to have a reference in point to do this. So now we're gonna use an exercise for you to actually achieve this yourself. Test this yourself on how this works on blockchain. This is just me using different things that are available, and we are going to go to a real blockchain, the Ethereum blockchain, to do this. So it is not a software. It is not something that someone has made or something like that. You're probably just going to use all the public open doors to do this. So for this exercise, you're going to have, you saw earlier on in the last module, my little Word document where I'm saying that I made this design and I made a fingerprint of that document. Well, I'm giving you five different versions. One is the truth one. One is the good fingerprint. The other ones don't. So you will have to do the activity of searching to identify what are the fingerprints or the hash. It's the format MD5, the same as we saw earlier on. It's the short one. So you will have to find the hash of all those documents, note them down. And now you need to find the one that I've hidden in Ethereum blockchain. When I say hidden, what I did there is I've actually sent Ethereum, if you don't know, is a cryptocurrency. It's not Bitcoin. It's another one, Ethereum. And it has a little bit more programmable logic. Let's park this now. But what I did is I actually sent myself a transaction. I sent myself some money and I put a note while I did this. And because it's on blockchain, it's traced or it's there forever. It's a block. It's part of a block. And it's possible, because it's public, to actually go there. If you know the code, I'm going to give them to you to find that transaction. You will see my transaction, how much I paid for it, actually, to make it happen. And you'll be able to identify this hash, this find, and to figure it out, to see it. And from there, you're going to get the answer. This notarization principle is not new. This is something we do and we use everywhere in everyone, in most of every human activities. It's all over the place. What is different on blockchain is that you don't need a middleman. You don't need a notary that is sitting down with a scribe. You yourself, just like I did it myself, I notarize something myself for my own desire with nobody involved. And that is very different because since the beginning of times, we have no other way than to use either a third party or to trust that what the promise has been made will be fulfilled or that people will keep their words. It's this good faith principle, and it has to do with that we have no other way. And also in terms of security, because blockchain lives on the internet by itself, it's not owned. Some of it will go into that, but it lives there without nobody that can actually change it, and it has its logic to stay alive, kind of. It makes it a point of reference on the internet, which is immutable, and that is quite interesting for evolution. So what can we do with this? Well, it has started, right? It's the first, what is one of the most trusting thing that people really like? It's money. So it's not very surprising that cryptocurrency is where it all started and where all things are happening, decentralized finance and money and currency and liquidity and all what's in the news, pretty much because money is one of the most sensible area where humans like to have trust. And if the trust is provided by a machine or the internet without any banks, financial system in the middle, they can just themselves have some money and actually change ownership to someone else. They're not transferring it. They're just writing a block on blockchain that it's not theirs, it's someone else. It's changing the status of ownership on a block and the other person has it. That's that. There is no transfer in terms of the way we understand it. It's not only in money, you also have around all identity, the principle of how you log into websites and how you prove that you are who you are. Trying to keep anonymity, we'll have an entire session on this as well, because that is very much key. We don't want people to be owning our privacy, our data. And then it goes on, certification, can you prove who is certified or not? Access, I have a badge to access a building. I was fired yesterday, but I didn't tell anybody. I can still access it, it works. That's a trust issue. A blockchain story can come in here, and so on. So the innovation that you hear about blockchain are all linked to the fact that we have this absolutely new thing that we don't really know what to do with at the moment. The fact that we can do trust by the internet on its own without having third party. Now, is there a catch? Well, when we say immutability, it seems like a promise and it seems like a religion and those kind of things, right? So yes, there is always the idea of leaving something behind forever. Privacy, I don't want that. I cannot erase it. What are we going to do with that? That's a little bit of an ouch into this. People might be concerned about that. And is it really, really immutable? That's always the question. Is there someone that can change it? They will always have discussion around that. So once again, how trustworthy is that trustworthiness, right? And it's a very fair question that is there. Now, there is also the way today's how we do this involves government, regulation, laws. It involves policies, how we work with each other, codes, ethics, everything of that has this middleman in the middle, or this principle of good faith in the middle. And now you have this thing on the internet that could actually do this. So a cryptocurrency that doesn't have oversight for government, how are you going to pay your taxes? You can hide things in there and change ownership and this and that, and nobody sees it. Oh, that's strange. And so on. Is it going to be like that? I'm not going to give you an answer, but those are very, very valid questions, but they are society questions. They are really linked to how we function as a society, and blockchain is actually scratching this. It's still tickling us and to understand. And in here, once again, I don't have the answer, and I'm not saying one is good or the other is bad. I'm just saying, you know, make your own mind on those topics. The last part here, and that's going to segue to one of the topics coming up, is that it can be very computer intensive. Bitcoin uses a lot of electricity. It's not very green. It's a problem. And, you know, so it needs to be addressed. It's also a big concern about this. So with this, let's move on to the next module. Blockchain, who owns it? Anybody owns it? I said kind of no, but is there an alternative? We'll see about that.